together as we celebrate the good news that Christ is risen. So we welcome you all to our 10 o'clock traditional worship service, and we hope that everybody is able to celebrate at home with us, and that you are able to have a day today that reflects the good news that God is with us, and that God has given us new life, and that we are truly blessed as God's people. As we begin this time together, I want to welcome Morin as our soloist again today, and for Vincent Rufino for being our musical accompaniment as he shares his gifts of music as well. So I know that we are not able to be in person, but hopefully the gifts of music and the gifts of space here coming to you will help you be centered in this Easter celebration. And so trying to think if we have a few announcements today. I'll be on vacation this next week, and we will find some sort of recorded service to post next Sunday for you all. And then the following Sunday, April 18th, we will be back in person. So we are working on that, and so we will continue to give that information to you all, and it will be nice to be able to once again be together as this body of Christ in this place. So as we gather to hear these words, the good news, and the gift of this special day. Easter people, rejoice, for God is good and faithful. Easter people, rejoice, for God brings love and hope. Easter people, rejoice, for all things work together for God. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Our opening hymn is just those words, Jesus Christ is risen today.
Thank you.
when everything was dark and it seemed that the sun would never shine again, your love broke through. Your love was too strong, too wide, too deep for death to hold. The sparks cast by your love dance and spread and burst forth with resurrection light. Gracious God, we praise you for the light of new life made possible through Jesus. We praise you for the light of new life that shone on the first witnesses of resurrection. We praise you for the light of new life that continues to shine in our hearts today. We pray that the Easter light of life, hope, and joy will live in us each day, and that we will be bearers of that light into the lives of others. Amen. Friends, I don't know what better good news there is than that we can say that Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed, but we do traditionally also share the good news. So let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. And if it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Friends, this is the good news that Jesus brings to us in our lives and that we seek to live as Easter people. So let us now virtually share the peace of Christ with one another as we have been continuing to do during this time. So the peace of Christ be with you all on this blessed Easter morning. And our hymn is "The Strife Is Over."
Thank you.
today comes from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 25, beginning with verse 6. He shares this message. He says, "On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wine strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of this people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Amen." And now we have an anthem called "Alleluia is Our Song."
What hope we have, even in the
reading today comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 16, beginning with verse 1. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. That is Jesus. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place that they laid him, but go. Tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Words of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So several years ago, I started my Easter sermon with you all saying this. I asked this question: what if? What if you had arrived here this morning and there were no beautiful flowers decorating the sanctuary? And thank you, Linda and Dick Schulte, for always making sure we have the flowers decorating the sanctuary. But what if they weren't here? And what if there was no beautiful music to center you in worship? What if you came today to worship and your expectations were not met? Would Easter still be Easter? Little did I know, several years ago, when I asked these questions, we would be on our second Easter where we couldn't gather in person. Last year, we weren't in the sanctuary. We didn't have our flowers. We had some forsythia I had cut from my yard, but it wasn't what we're used to. Is Easter still Easter? Friends, we are not giving up. We are still telling the story of Easter. We are still finding ways to celebrate and give thanks to our loving God for the gift of new life through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But we do have expectations. Expectations. Once, many years ago, I served at a different church. A family arrived early they had two Christmas Eve worship services, and they came to the earlier service. And they were shocked to see that we were worshiping in the chapel rather than in the sanctuary. You see, this family had moved away, and they had not stayed connected with this church for a very, very long time. But they found that their family was finally all together for the Christmas season, and so they decided as a family to drive out from the city to come to this home church that they had once attended to celebrate Christmas Eve together as a family. Except we weren't worshiping in the sanctuary. And they let me know that they had very deep disappointments that they had traveled so far, and that that beautiful sanctuary is what made Christmas Christmas. On the other hand, those active church members that were accustomed to the early service being in the chapel loved being in that smaller, more intimate location. It gave them a relaxed, family-friendly atmosphere to gather and celebrate Christmas. It all comes down to expectations. Expectations. Now, I'll be honest, I've had the privilege of ruining several different people's Christmases in several different churches on more than one occasion. But I hope you're with me on this. It really shouldn't be about us and our expectations. But it really should be more about what God has done and is still doing in the world, in our lives, and in the faith story. Without the flowers, without the music, would Easter still be Easter? Can Easter still be Easter if we're worshiping virtually rather than in person? I know it's different, I know it's hard, and we yearn so much to be together again, but Easter transcends our building. And thankfully, it transcends our expectations. So early in the morning, a small group of women come. They come to this final resting place of their beloved friends. They come as the dark of night is ending and a hint of the light begins to shine as it offers itself to the world. They come expecting to find things as they should be, with a stone covering the entrance of a tomb. And why should they expect anything else? In life, there are things that just are. The sun rises in the morning and sets in the evening. Winter ends and thankfully spring begins. The cycle of life is definite. People are born and they die. And so as they come that morning and find the stone has been moved, fear begins to fill their heart. And so as the women enter the tomb and they see this young man sitting there, before they're able to speak any words, but it says they are filled with alarm. We're given this insight into their emotions. There are no words spoken, but we get a sense of how they're feeling. And the young man says, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here." It's as if this young man was reading their minds. He knows before they have a chance to ask, right? Wouldn't you say, "Where is he? Where is he gone? What have you done with him? What has happened?" But this young man holds the answers to their fears, to their concerns, to their confusion, and he responds before they even ask. They expected Jesus to be in the tomb. They come with a purpose. They come to anoint him with these spices. But he is not there. And then, after explaining that Jesus is not there, don't panic. No one has stolen his body. He's alive. He's risen. The young man gives them directions. At first, he's trying to calm that anxiety. Do not be alarmed. But then he gives a very direct command. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. And there you will see him, just as he told you. Now, if you've taken the time to look at Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Each of them tells the story of the one woman, a group of women coming to the tomb. Jesus is not there in all four of them, but each story is a little different. And in Mark seems to be a little more different. It is dramatically different, in my opinion, because in Mark, the women have come to the tomb, they learn Jesus is not there, they're given the good news that he is risen, but rather than going as they were commanded to, Mark's gospel ends with, "So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid." They said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Mark is the only one that ends this way. And all the others, the women go back and tell them the story. So why does Mark say they said nothing? Could it be that in the Gospel of Mark, the expectations get the better of these women, that everything that was supposed to happen didn't, and it's just too much for them to comprehend? Could it be in Mark that they miss out on the true gift of Easter because it was not the way it was supposed to be? Could it be that Mark is trying to show what it's like to be too stuck in how life works? And when that happens, we can miss out on a sacred gift, a gift that is supposed to shatter our expectations, a gift that is supposed to bring us into a new understanding of God and Jesus Christ. What is Mark doing? Why do these women not share the good news? So one of my professors in seminary, he was an expert on the Gospel of Mark. When he taught this, he said that he feels the gospel writer ended it this way because he wants us to take the story forward. He wants us to pick up where the women left off. The women were too afraid to tell others what they discovered, but we are the ones to have courage. We are the ones to enter the story and to go and share the news. I like this approach. If you know me, I like what it means when Scripture calls us to immerse ourselves in it. And to let it be a part of our lives, part of our stories, right? Last Sunday, with Palm Sunday, like, we want those palms because it helps us become embedded in the story. It's not just something flat on the page that we read, we become a part of it. Could it be that Mark is calling us to be a part of this? Be interactive is very popular right now, right? Museums have redesigned themselves to be more interactive. And now, with my daughter, I'm learning that there are shows on Netflix that allow you to be interactive. You watch the show up to a certain point, and then it says, which do you choose, A, B, or C? And you can choose on Netflix, and then it brings you to whatever choice and tells the story from there. So the same show might have five or six different ways to tell the story. I remember reading books when I was a kid like that, and I would put little bookmarks in it every time. It was like, okay, if you want this ending or this choice, go to page 65, but if you want this choice, go to page 32. And I put a bookmark because I always wanted to make sure I knew every single direction the story could have gone. So it was fun to read those books, but it was also full of little bookmarks. So is Mark on the cutting edge of being an interactive storyteller? If so, here we are at the point in the story
The women are told, go, tell the disciples and Peter. What would we choose? A, do nothing. B, go and tell the disciples and Peter. Or C, continue looking for Jesus on your own. And I think these are still valid choices in our lives today. A, do nothing. Today is Easter, and for some it's a holiday, but not a holy day. And there's nothing about it that connects us to a deeper spiritual fulfillment. So we'll enjoy the day, have a special meal, and let the kids have an Easter egg hunt. B, go. Go and tell others. B, right? People seek to be in community together. As we gather as the body of Christ, we come to share the good news, to proclaim that Christ is risen, that together our lives are enriched from this incredible gift from God. And hopefully we share some of those sacred moments in our lives with each other. Or C, go and find Jesus on their own. Well, I can do this faith thing on my own. I'm spiritual, but not religious. I don't really see a need to be part of a larger faith community. And, well, I'll just practice my faith in God on my own. I can do that. A, B, C. And I'm sure there's plenty of other choices as well. Right? This is interactive. We have a choice. And hopefully, if you're viewing here today and participating in our service, Easter is more than just a, more than just a holiday. And hopefully, it's more than just C, where you're just trying to find Jesus on your own. Hopefully, we're gathered together to be a community that proclaims the risen Christ. Because together, we are that body, and together, we are to do that work that Christ calls us into. Easter is a day of great joy, a day of celebration, a day when we proclaim that death does not have the last word. That God's love overcomes even the darkest of human sin. Coming back to that word, expectations. Expectations. God cannot be determined or defined by what we think should and should not be. Throughout his entire life, Jesus disrupted the traditional practices, rules, and rituals. He challenged the way things were, and he provoked people to think differently. And even in his death, he challenges the way things are. So when we enter the divine story, we cannot come to it with expectations. We must let go of what we think should be and allow the work of God to surprise us, to connect us in new ways. And when we allow that, it should get into us in a way that perhaps we're not controlling. But the Holy Spirit is at work to transform us more deeply in our spiritual journey. We never know when the Easter story is going to break into our lives and change everything. These women expected things to be the way they should be, and when they are not, they are filled with grief, loss, fear. And throughout our lives, changes happen, transformations can take us in a direction that was completely unexpected. And perhaps those are stories that should be shared with others. Join the story. Join the story of the unexpected. Join the story of how the God of new life life, of new creation, of resurrection is at work. Not just in our own lives, but here in this faith community. For the work that we together, in what we call the body of Christ, right? Because of that resurrection, we believe we are now participating as Christ's body here, right? As we seek to do his work in this world. And together we share stories of lives changed and hope restored and love poured out through fellowship and prayer. And even when our expectations are not met, let us stay in the story. Let us continue to name our questions and our concerns and our fears. And maybe, just maybe, in the midst of it all, the risen Christ will appear. And that is good news. Because when Christ surprises us, we get that understanding of God's unconditional love. And that God truly is working and growing us to be the new creation. Amen. Our communion anthem is called Redemption Song.
Life from life sustaining us, earth below and
When Jane asked me to listen to this anthem on YouTube, I said, oh, that's going to sound beautiful with Lauren's voice. And again, thank you. What a beautiful, beautiful centering in worship, and the words are very powerful as well. Friends, as we gather on this Easter Sunday and celebrate the new creation, the new life, the gift of love that God has given to us through the resurrection, we come and break bread together. This is not a Presbyterian table, but this is God's table. And thankfully, we've been able to extend our way of celebrating communion together beyond the building, together, but out into the world and into our lives and in our homes as well. So here are these words. God of mercy, we no longer look for Jesus among the dead, for he is alive and has become the Lord of life. From the waters of death, you raised us with him and renew your gift of life within us. Increase in our minds and hearts the risen life we share with Christ, and help us to grow as your people toward the fullness of eternal life with you. Through Christ our Lord. You are holy, a God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, whom you sent to save us. He came with healing in his touch and was wounded for our sins. He came with mercy in his voice and was mocked as one despised. He came with peace in his heart and met with violence and death. By your power, he broke free from the prison of the tomb, and at his command, the gates of hell were opened. The one who was dead now lives. The one who humbled himself is raised to rule over all creation, the Lamb upon the throne. The one ascended on high is with us always, as he promised. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and cup. For the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this feast, united in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. Amen. Friends, we gathered not too long ago, just a few days on Maundy Thursday, and we remembered the story of Jesus gathering with his disciples and friends to celebrate the Passover feast. And as they gathered together, Jesus knew that one would betray him. But all were invited. And all were allowed to participate in the meal. For God's grace is abundant. And so Jesus took the bread, and he blessed it, and he gave thanks to God, and he broke it. And he said, take, eat, this is my body, broken for you. And in the same way, he took the cup and he said, this is the cup of the new covenant sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I invite you to take your bread and in whatever manner you're comfortable with. You can either take your bread by itself, or if you want to dip it in your cup, the body of Christ and the cup of the new covenant.
Let us pray. Nourished at this table, O God, may we know Christ's redemptive love and living new life in him. Help us who recognize our Lord in the breaking of bread to see and serve him in all whose lives are broken. Give us who are fed at his hand grace to share our bread with the hungry and the hungry of heart. Keep us faithful in your service until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast with all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. Amen. Our closing hymn is one of my Easter favorites, Thine is the Glory. Upon each and every one, now and forever.